Hello, and welcome to today's webinar from Blue Marble Geographics and Base9 Geodetic Consulting. My name is Patrick Cunningham, and I'll be doing the introductions and moderating today. I'm the president of Blue Marble Geographics, and I'm very excited to welcome you to today's webinar. Today's presenters will, as I said, will be myself. I'm the president of Blue Marble. I've been with the company since 2003. I'm the head of operations, software development, and sales and marketing. With me today will be Sam Knight, who is our director of product management. Sam's responsible for the development of Blue Marble training, Blue Marble product features and functions, and the leader of our tech support as well. And we're joined today by Dave Doyle from Base9 Geodetic Consulting, also former Chief Geodetic Surveyor with National Geodetic Survey. There's a little bit of background on Dave, if you're not familiar with Dave. He joined National Geodetic Survey in 1972 and held the position of Chief Geodetic Surveyor at his retirement in January of 2013. He was responsible for the development, technical design, and management of plans and programs that enhanced the United States National Spatial Reference System. He's also provided technical assistance in geodesy to international, federal, state, and local surveying, mapping, and GIS agencies. Mr. Doyle has published more than 30 articles on geodesy and geodetic surveying in national and local surveying publications, and he's conducted more than 400 workshops and seminars detailing the various aspects of geodesy and the National Spatial Reference System. Mr. Doyle continues to support education in geodesy for surveyors and others interested in high-accuracy geospatial data through seminars and surveying and GIS conferences. He is available via Base9 Geodetic Consulting, and we'll be putting up his contact information later in the talk. Of course, Blue Marble is also available for consulting and assistance with geodesy, and we're very happy to provide this webinar today to continue to promote geodetic education, and we're excited to do that in partnership with Mr. Doyle. So as a little bit of overview for the agenda today, after I'm done here, we're going to hand it right over to Sam, and he's going to dive deep into projections, as is the title of today's webinar, and he'll give you a good overview on projections as best as he can, as best as one can, in 25 minutes. Obviously, there is a lot to learn and go over with coordinate systems projection and geodesy, but hopefully this primer will be a good context for the next part of the talk, which would be led by Mr. Doyle. We'll be understanding common projection coordinate systems. After all that is wrapped up, we'll then open things up for questions and answers, hopefully, for the ending of the webinar. We encourage you to take notes as you're listening. We do also have the ability to answer some questions through the GoToMeeting instant messaging question and answer features, which Sam has just flipped over to show you a little bit of that. It may take us a little bit to get to your questions. If we don't get to them all today, we will do our best to follow up with you afterwards. And as I said earlier, you are able to contact our speakers today directly after the webinar as well. You can see the slide here gives you a little bit of background on how to use the interface, and it's just to the right of your GoToWebinar tools. And as we said, we'll do our best to answer some as we can throughout the presentation. And so without further ado, I'm going to hand things over to Sam to get started with our deep dive into projections. Sam?
Okay, thank you, Patrick. Good afternoon, everyone. As we get rolling here into projections, I got a couple of comments from folks out in the world about sound. I just want to make sure everybody can hear us okay. So if you could use on your GoToMeeting, GoToWebinar controls, if you could use the hands up tool to tell me that you are able to hear us okay, that will just reassure me to keep on talking here. Okay, looks like we've got some folks that can hear us, so we're going to keep right on rolling. So the topic for today is map projections. Map projections builds off of some stuff that we talked about in our last geodetics session that we held back in June or July, I believe that was. That session was all about the datum and the basis of coordinate systems being various geometric reference frames, horizontal datums. We talked about a fair bit of vocabulary. We're going to start a little farther down the line this time. We're going to take a very speedy recap on where we actually begin with that, on what exactly a datum is, and we're going to fast forward into the nuts and bolts of building a projected map out of that. So the ultimate problem of mapping is that we have a three-dimensional world, and we need to model that in two dimensions in order to get that on paper or to get that onto a screen in front of us. So we have our three-dimensional world. First, we need to describe the size and shape of that planet. We're going to establish a datum. It's going to give us that size and shape of the planet. We're going to put down some basic reference lines, and we'll have a latitude-longitude geodetic coordinate system. That is really where projection begins. We first have to come up with the model of the planet we're going to be projecting onto that flat surface. Then we can get into selecting the surface that we're going to be projecting onto, and you'll see there's a few shapes we've got there for step three. Once we do the math to flatten out our three-dimensional globe onto our projected surface, then we can slice these up one side, if it's a cylinder, if it's a cone, things like that, and we can unroll it to get our final flattened 2D piece of paper that is our map. So we're going to be talking quickly here at the beginning, my section, 25 minutes. It's practically impossible to get too deep in that amount of time, but we're going to talk about the basics of map projection, and then Dave's going to follow on with some much, much more detailed specifics on particular projections. So the size and shape of the planet. First, we have this large roundish object that we need to make a model of. So first we need to characterize the size and shape of that thing. So there's a vocab word here at the very beginning, ellipsoid and spheroid. A lot of folks run into confusion between the two of those. I'm going to round off all the corners and say that for the purposes of this discussion, an ellipsoid and a spheroid are exactly the same thing. Newton popularized this idea, took a very simple shape, this 2D ellipse on the right here. It's described simply by two axes. We have an A axis, we call that the semi-major. We talk about the radius of the larger dimension, the semi-minor, the radius of the slightly smaller dimension. In this case, it's our polar axis. Newton's term was an oblate ellipsoid of revolution. So what that means is we're going to spin this two-dimensional object around that B axis, our polar axis, and the three-dimensional shape that would occupy by spinning that around that axis is going to describe the size and shape of the entire planet for us. So the size we're talking about, just shy of 8,000 miles, the diameter across the equator is about 7,927 miles, and at the poles, it's closer to about 7,900 miles even. So we're only looking at about 27 miles difference across an object 8,000 miles in diameter. So very, very small difference between those two. We're talking about something that is almost perfectly round, but just not quite. To get a little farther into the weeds with that, I'd encourage you to go back and check out our recorded session on datums, where we go a lot farther with ellipsoids and horizontal datums and geometric reference frames. The next bit of vocab, we're going to take that ellipsoid, we're going to turn it into a horizontal datum or a geometric reference frame. Geometric reference frame is going to be a term you're going to hear Dave mention a bunch of times as we talk about our modern coordinate systems. The simplistic view is they're pretty much the same thing on a basic academic level. In modern times, I'm going to let Dave sort of split that difference for us and clarify what exactly that means for us as we get a little farther down the road. The base datum that we're talking about is the first thing we can actually create a map on. So it takes the ellipsoid shape that we have, it's going to pin it down to the surface, so we're actually going to virtually tie it to the dirt of the planet. We're going to give it an origin, which is going to be the equator and some reference meridian. So in most cases, for most people, that's going to be the Greenwich meridian, located at the base point of that being the Greenwich Observatory outside of London in England. other folks around the world, there are a few others. There are about 12 different prime meridians. But whichever one of those we pick, that's going to be the basis of our east-west measurement, our zero starting point on that ellipsoid surface. So the basic relationship is a one-way street. You can have an ellipsoid without it implicitly being any particular datum. Ellipsoids get used in a bunch of different datums, but an individual datum uses one and only one ellipsoid. So if you have a specific datum, that means you have one very specific ellipsoid, but that ellipsoid can be recycled into a few different datums used all over different parts of the planet. The next step is to take that datum and turn it into a geodetic coordinate system. And really what that means is we're going to take those two reference lines, we're going to take the equator and the prime meridian. So here in red on our basic map here, the equator being the midline between the poles, and the prime meridian being that arbitrarily chosen starting place for our geodetic coordinate system or latitude-longitude system. So the prime meridian is going to give us the basis of that east-west measurement. The equator is going to give us the basis of that north-south measurement. Really, the difference between a horizontal datum and the geodetic coordinate system comes down to rules about the origin, what units we're going to be measuring in. And again, for most folks, that's going to be degree-based measurements, but there are a few places around the world you might run into some alternate units, things like grads and radians. For some older mapping systems back in colonial times around the world. So for the most part, we're talking about a latitude-longitude-based system using Greenwich as the prime meridian, the start point for our zero east-west, and the equator for our zero north-south. So that gets us all the way up to establishing the size and shape of the planet. Once we actually get to projection, we're going to start with that geodetic coordinate system, and we're going to contain that or touch it up against another geometric shape. So there are some really common shapes that we use, and we've got those on screen now. Things such as just simply a flat plane. So we might touch our geodetic coordinate system, a globe if you will, we might touch that right up against a two-dimensional plane, and we're going to stick a light bulb somewhere near that globe. In our illustration on top here, that light bulb is in the center of the ball. That light bulb could be projecting through that globe on the outside of the ball, might be touching the outside of the ball, it might be infinitely far away from that ball. But the idea is that mathematically we're going to be projecting that light through that three-dimensional geodetic coordinate system onto our two-dimensional plane. We can see all of our latitudes and longitude meridians and parallels projecting off onto that 2D plane, and in the case of our azimuthal plane, it's going to give us a sort of a pie-shaped map, in this case of the North Pole. Down in the conic section here, instead of using a 2D shape, we're going to be using a cone. So we're essentially going to put a hat down on top of the planet. We're going to put our light bulb inside that globe, and again, it could come from somewhere outside, could come from the center of the globe. We're going to shine that light through the globe surface and project the surface off onto the inside of that cone, slice it up one side, and then unroll our cone to get a 2D flat map. Looks very, very different from our azimuthal map. And then lastly, repeating the same process, same idea with the cylinder. Here we wrap the cylinder around the equator. We're going to be talking about different ways we can wrap that cylinder around the ball that are going to do some different things to our map. Each of these shapes can be oriented to the planet in different ways, and there's some different terminology that goes along with those that we'll be bumping into as we talk about some particular projections. There is a lot of terminology that goes hand in hand with projection. So we're going to step through a few bits of vocabulary here and sort of build up on the concepts here. So some basic terminology. We have azimuth. This is something we're going to be talking about a bit here. There's a few other words for azimuth. Heading, bearing, direction. What we're talking about here are talking about the direction of travel. If we're navigating across a map, we're going to be following the path of an azimuth. That's going to be measured typically from some version of north. There's a couple of versions of north that we're going to be talking about. And you'll see I've got two lines on screen here. So I have a projected map. In this case, this is a Mercator projected map, which has some very particular properties. We'll be talking about some of those properties as we go. The Great Circle I've got indicated in red here. This is something like an orbital path. If you imagine holding a globe in your hand, and you take your hand and you basically orbit that around the surface of the globe in a circle, the path that you would be tracing off on the surface of that globe in this projected sense would be this sine curve going across our flattened map. That happens to be the shortest distance between any two points around the perimeter there. It's a lot harder to actually navigate when we put that into a two-dimensional flattened map such as this. The rum line, which is going to be that dark blue line going across the page, that's a much, much simpler navigational tool. So it is a straight line in this context, and it's very simple for navigation because of the properties of this particular map. It is not the shortest distance between two lines, but it is much, much easier to navigate since we hold a fixed path between any of those two points. Dave, I'm just going to mute your mic for a second. I think we're picking up a little extra noise between us here. Okay. So some more terminology, some projection terms. Now, in maps that are not like that Mercator projection, we have this term called convergence. And this is where we get back into those two different versions of north that I was talking about. So we have true north and grid north. So both of those norths are reflected on this diagram. True north, you can see the black lines, those are going to be all of our meridians. Those are all converging up at the North Pole. So the North Pole is what we call true north. Grid north is simply straight up on the page wherever we happen to be on a projected map. So our red grid here, this is reflecting our lines going up to grid north. And if we follow the path of our red arrows imposed on that grid, you'll see they all go straight up to the top of the page. The black lines are going into true north. So at a particular point where we might be standing on the map at the bottom of these lines, there is an angle between those two paths to the two different versions of north. Those are very important when we're talking about navigation. If we're talking about true north or grid north, we need to understand the relationship between where those two versions of north are in a given spot on that map. Now you'll see on the western portion of our map over here, the angle would be going in one direction, we'd be going positive clockwise. In the other direction, we would be going negative clockwise. In the center of the map there, we would be going straight towards the top of the page in both contexts, in true north and grid north. So at that central meridian of our projection here, what we would actually have is converging versions of both of those north lines. So the convergence angle in this case would be zero. So it changes all over the map. It's very important to keep track of. If you're using bearings along any of those navigational lines, whether it's a true north or a grid north, basically just to keep track of where you are and what direction you're actually heading. Scale factor is another much more sort of obvious problem for a lot of folks on maps. These are bits we've heard about a lot recently. I've seen a lot of stuff going around social media. It usually makes the rounds once or twice a year. About how particular projections are very distorted, and so Mercator projection is a horrible projection, and nothing is good when we use it. And we all grow up seeing these wall maps that are lying to us about the nature of the world. The real story there is that it's not that the maps are inaccurate because they distort in certain ways. It's just that they're not useful for particular types of measurements. And mathematically, we can keep track of where all those various distortions are. So just because it's mathematically distorted doesn't necessarily mean that it is inherently wrong. So scale factor is a very approachable one here. You'll see on, now bear with me for a second, because we are looking at two-dimensional maps here. One, I'm synthesizing a three-dimensional globe shape, and I'm superimposing two square areas of the same size over that map. And then we reproject the map into this Mercator map view, and you'll see we have a drastically different scale distortion that is going to be a linear distance stretch that translates into an area stretch as well between the difference of those two projections. So an area measured on one may not proportionally reflect the area measured on another. And that's going to lead us back into some of the properties, along with scale factor, the navigational lines, and the convergence angles. Those are going to take us into the four basic properties that we can have on a map. So we can maintain things like area. That is pretty much what it sounds like. From the real world on a globe, we proportionally measure surface areas. Distance, an equidistant map, it's not entirely what it sounds like. An equidistant map preserves distances from the center point specifically of the projection to other points, but not necessarily all points across the map. True direction maps have no convergence distortion, and that is they actually stretch the North Pole all the way across the top of the projected map. And a good example of that is the Mercator, one we just looked at, we'll be looking at again in a second. And conformality of angles in our projection. The conformal projections, we're going to see a few examples of these, really because they're the backbone of modern surveying coordinate systems, where angles are very, very key into the geometry and all of the measurements that are made between the projected space and the real world. Now, some of these are mutually exclusive, and some of them can be combined. And all of these four basic properties, the reason we have so many projections to choose from is because they all represent different combinations of these four basic properties that we're going to be measuring on our maps. So some of the particular named projections, such as Mercator, this is one of us, a lot of us have grown up with, a Mercator map on the wall of our elementary schools. As we're children, I grew up with one of these. We had a huge wall size one in my, I remember it was in my fifth grade geography classroom. And I very distinctly remember getting into an argument with my fifth grade teacher, as a 10-year-old boy, getting into an argument with my teacher about how large Greenland actually was. Because we also had a globe in the room, and pretty much anybody could look at the globe and look at the wall map and see that there was something different between those two. Gerardus Mercator was a Flemish cartographer. He lived back in the 1500s. He designed this projection not to be a great world projection for going on polar expeditions, but he was very specifically interested in creating a map that was going to be faithful right around the equator. So within about 15 degrees of the equator, the area I've marked off here in the dark blue box, that's going to be a pretty solid map. And if we just kind of focus on that section, we'll see fairly minimal distortion in there. As we get closer to the poles, we see we've got some very obvious distortion. It appears as if Antarctica has the same land mass as just about the rest of the continents put together. Greenland distorts to, I think it's something about 6 to 10 times its normal size in terms of area. But in terms of navigational measurements, this is a very solid option if you're going to be making a worldwide expedition.
You know, I'll just add what's sad about today is you go into that fifth grade classroom and there aren't a lot of those maps hanging on the walls anymore. I think we need to bring them back, you know.
So the modern projection, a lot more of us use day in and day out, is called transverse Mercator. And so this is one of those vocab words, transverse. Really, that just means we're going to take the normal aspect of that projection, which is a cylindrical projection wrapping around the equator, and we're going to turn that cylinder sideways. So we're going to wrap it around a meridian instead. What that does for us is it lets us get a good, very long north-south extent, specifically along one meridian, going all the way from pole to pole. This projection is probably our most common, by far, projection that folks are actually using day in, day out. It's the basis of the universal transverse Mercator systems. A lot of folks are familiar with as UTM. A lot of folks are using that and they don't even know exactly what it is. It's the basis for most national grids around the planet. And here in the United States, it's the basis of a pretty good majority of our state plane zones from state to state. So because we have a line of contact along one single meridian, it's going to give us a very long north-south extent, and distances are going to be true along that central meridian or two standard meridians if we've got a variable. Now the data we're looking at here, we're going to take a couple of views on each of those maps. The data on the left, the large sort of football-shaped map, is world data crammed into UTM zone 19. The view on the right, the smaller subset here, indicating the area of Maine, that is basically just this same map zoomed in with a couple other layers turned on. So we're going to take some world views and we're going to take a look at this small region of Maine here. And then the reason we're looking at Maine is because that's happened to be where Patrick and I are sitting right now. So Lambert conformal conic, same thing. We've got the world data crammed into a custom Lambert conformal conic that I centered again on our area here in Maine. When we take a look at the rest of the planet, we can see we've got some obvious distortion. South America blows up huge, Australia, Africa, Asia flips upside down, splits apart in the middle. So we have some very obvious convergence distortion in a number of places there. But if we focus in towards the center, where I put this, then again we see a fairly reasonable depiction of the state of Maine. In this region, we're typically talking about middle latitude maps, so we're not at the poles, we're not at the equator. We're going to be following along a single or two sets of parallels, and along those parallels where our cone is going to be either tangent or secant to the planet. So tangent would be if we have one single parallel that we're making contact on. Secant would be if we actually sink that cone through the surface of the globe a little bit. We're going to have two rings. Some properties of this, we're going to have true distance measurement only along those standard parallels. In the central area of the map, we're going to have reasonable accuracy of area and our angles are going to be very nicely maintained. Conformal is actually in the name. So what that's going to do for us is bring those basic shapes of areas onto our projected map. Another one here, stereographic. This is also a conformal projection. It's no surprise that we've got three conformal projections because these are sort of three of the most common systems that are laid down by surveyors for use all over the globe, whether it's a local state plane zone or it's a national zone for one of the smaller countries in Europe. Stereographic, Lambert conformal, and transverse Mercator, three very, very heavy hitters in terms of common use. So a stereographic map, that is an azimuthal map. That's going to touch down a two-dimensional plane directly to one point on the globe. That's going to give us equidistant properties. So any straight line passing through the center point of that projection is going to be a great circle and also be a true distance measurement for us. Because it is a conformal projection, the angular relationships of points and shapes are maintained into our 2D. If we focus on just particular areas in there, you can see things like the orientation of Greenland to the rest of North America. You can see things like Madagascar in relation to the rest of Africa, and so on. Stereographic is probably used a little bit less commonly here in the States. Some of you may, if you're listening from inside the States, you maybe have heard of the City of Fargo municipal coordinate system. That's a stereographic. Our Canadian friends north of the border use a double stereographic in some parts of Nova Scotia, for example, as well. And it's a little bit more commonly used in some parts of Europe as well. Basically continent-sized areas as long as they are in similar extents in all directions from the center point. So again, zooming in over here to our local region for us here in Maine, we're not so much longer in any direction north-south as east-west. As long as we plunk down the center point right in the middle of our projection, we can fairly reasonably describe this area using a stereographic as well. So that micro level, we typically see much, much smaller distortions using alternate projections. going out to, again, that sort of macro level, that global level here in our stereographic plane, we see things like some of the islands of Indonesia, New Guinea, etc., stretching out much, much larger, massive scale distortion, massive convergence angle distortion from our two versions of north and so on. But as long as we fit our projection around the area that we're trying to preserve, as long as we have designed this with certain scales in mind, a number of different projections can suitably describe that same area. So a few more projections. These are just some common cartographic examples. So we've got some Winkel in here. We've got some Van der Grinten in here. A few common global projections. There are many, many, many ways to make that projection of the three-dimensional globe onto a two-dimensional plane. They all have drastically different geometry. It's very often best to research the particular combination of parameters you're looking at in a coordinate system or a base projection itself to tell you what can be reliably measured on a map, whether it's going to be things like distance, area, direction, or the internal angles of some of those shapes. In modern use, there are about probably 90 some odd projections that are still encountered in a lot of mapping systems. Everything from your common transverse Mercator out to some of these much more cartographic examples for world projection. So how do we make that choice? We need to have a projection that's going to suitably describe the extents we're looking at. So are we looking at a mid-latitude and an east-west extent? Maybe one of those conic projections would be a little better for us. Are we looking at a very long north-south extent or an extremely wide east-west extent down at the equator? That's going to be a very different choice for us. So fundamentally, it's going to come down to the purpose of your map. What measurements are you going to need to make from that map? And that's going to guide you into the properties that you need to maintain faithfully on that map once it's on paper or on your 2D screen. Once we've narrowed that down from that list of 90 some odd projections, we're going to have things like standards. Are you reporting to a state or federal or national agency? Are you following some internal business rules for your maps, and so on? So there's a lot to factor in, and this is just a very sort of quick skim across the surface. We're going to hand it over to Dave here in just a moment, and as we do that, let me change up our microphone. Dave, are you still there with me?
Oh yeah.
Okay, I just unmuted you. We were getting just a little bit of fuzz across the line. So I'd shut you off for a moment. I'm going to take a quick look at some questions here. I'm handing you control, Dave, so you should be seeing that now. Let's see here. We've had some questions about the recording. I think we might have forgotten to mention that at the beginning. We are recording this session. It's going to take us just a little bit to clean up the audio, the video, get it re-encoded and posted up on YouTube, but we are planning on pasting this up on our YouTube account, and that should be up in just a couple days' time. We have one interesting question here that's a good point of discussion. I mentioned some of the things we've seen around social media recently, and Greg is asking, any thoughts on Hajime Nurikawa's new projection? And for those of you not familiar with that, that is, it's sort of a geodesic projection. It's a little bit like the Fuller-Dymaxion. If you've ever bumped into that one, it's basically a projection of a number of triangles breaking up the globe into a number of much smaller shapes. I'll share my thoughts, then I'll hand it over to Dave. And if you have any thoughts on it, Dave, I think it's useful for sort of a cartographic example. I think it's an interesting exercise for stuff like printing it out, putting it back together with kids. Its usefulness in terms of GIS, which is where I spend most of my time, is probably a little bit more limited. But in general, I think it's a lot of fun. That's my sort of very quick two cents on it. Dave, are you familiar with this new one?
Yeah, I am a bit, and I have to agree with your comments there. Of course, I spend most of my time looking at the functionality of of the coordinate systems with respect to, you know, the actual mapping activities that people are engaged in day to day. And that one has not really come up yet, you know, in terms of, you know, organizations, communities, you know, trying to adapt that to their local mapping applications, at least not that I've seen.
Okay. Dave, I think I'm going to turn you loose to start your section of the presentation. And for those of you following along, I will be trying to manage some of the text questions that are coming in. So I'll be replying to some of you folks directly, and we'll save some of those again for the dedicated session at the end.
Good. Okay, thanks, Sam. I really appreciate this. I'd like to state right up front, first of all, you have my contact information here, and at no time should anyone out there, if you have comments about my section of the material that I'm going to cover, don't ever hesitate to drop me an email or give me a call. I'm more than happy to try and help you with it. One of the things I learned many, many decades ago during my time with the National Geodetic Survey is that because of the development of these tremendous tools and geographic information systems, GPS and now GNSS, there's a tremendous number of disciplines out there who are gravitating towards the use of high accuracy data without a general background in the geodesy and map projections. And Sam has done just a tremendous job here, you know, outlining some of the complexities of map projections, their uses, their design, and the overwhelming majority of folks have never really had anything like that unless you've gone through a university environment to take this up. One of the things to note here is that in the short period of time that we have, there's really not all that much you can kind of cover. I think we're really hitting the highlights here. What I would cover during the time that I've been allotted here this afternoon expands easily into a 4 or 8 hour workshop in terms of going down the rabbit hole. So I'm going to have to truncate quite a number of things just to, you know, be able to put this material together. So, what do we got here? Okay. One of the first things I want to talk about is the issue of metadata, coordinates and heights. I cannot say enough about the importance of this subject. I've seen hundreds, if not thousands, of documents that have been prepared that provide coordinate information, whether it's generated through GPS, GNSS observations, or typical surveyor traversing or running levels or whatever it is, that rarely, if ever, give the appropriate amount of information to share with others so that they can accurately look at that information and use it for whatever needs that they have. And we could spend days talking about metadata itself, the vast amount of information and metadata. Well, I'd like to just focus briefly here to ensure that everyone is familiar with data coordinates. If you're getting coordinates and their heights, you must have it related to the datum, right? Whether it's an older datum, such as the North American datum of 1927, or a more contemporary datum, the North American datum of 1983 for the United States. And even there, NAD83 has a number of iterations because of changes in positioning technology that have occurred since 1986 when the datum was released. Vertical datums, you have heights, you have what height system are you working with? Units of measure, meters, regrettably the United States is not a metric country, although the agency that's responsible for defining our national spatial reference system, the National Geodetic Survey, which traces its origin back to 1807, is a metric agency, and they produce data in feet for the use of the public. The United States, in terms of surveying and general mapping, uses two different foot units, the U.S. survey foot and the international foot, and I will describe those briefly in a few minutes. The one area that I think oftentimes is missed by so many people is the accuracy of data, coordinates, and heights. How well has something been defined? I have seen far too many documents that have been produced with, let's say, a state plane coordinate, northing and easting, and it's shown out to four decimal places, or heights to four or five decimal places. This is generally because that's what the computer generated. It has nothing to do with the integrity of the data itself. That is, how well were the measurements originally made in the field, and to what kind of control, that is, what kind of survey framework was it tied to? I highlight many times in presentations that I give, the number of digits to the right of the decimal point had nothing to do with accuracy. You can generate four or five decimal places, and in many cases that's fine. But make sure that the data, whether you're producing it or you're acquiring it from someone else, make sure that whatever that material is associated with some reasonable estimate of how good the data really is, so that people can grab one set of data, combine it with another, and assure that as they're trying to mix these pieces together, that their accuracy systems are at least matching, or you know how well the data was originally defined. Just a point here, that metadata heights and coordinates without metadata, compared to, let's say, a boundary line in Google Earth, well, you see my comment, just a wild guess, and I'll just leave it at that. Okay, here's a couple of examples. I just want to quickly go through this to highlight some things that I have seen, I have captured from professional documents that I will show you. I've got a couple here that I really like. In this one, a north arrow. This is very common on a surveyor's plat. And Sam did a good job describing the different types of north reference that we often see, whether it's grid north or it's magnetic north or it's true or geodetic north. And here's one. It's a north arrow that came off of a surveyor's plat. Nice little north arrow, nice little N that's drawn on there. And notice that the reference, the orientation, is given as NAVD88. Well, NAVD88 is a vertical datum, the North American vertical datum of 1988. It has nothing to do with coordinates in north. So the surveyor who was producing this obviously did not know much about his datum. I particularly like this one over here on the right from the Supreme Court of the United States. I love this one. It defines the offshore boundary between the United States and California, a very common thing that happens. But look at the datum. Remember, Sam talked about the differences in datums. Not all datums are the same. And here is one that draws a lot of comments. The relationship of the North American datum of 1983, which is the national horizontal, now commonly referenced as geometric, and I'm glad Sam brought that up, because there's a three-dimensional component now to what was classically a two-dimensional datum. NAD83 is the national mapping and surveying datum of the United States, whereas WGS84, World Geodetic System 1984, is the default coordinate system for the U.S. Navstar Global Positioning System. And they are considered to be the same. If you have data that's accurate to about 2.5 to 3 meters. So if you're dealing with data that has an uncertainty of, let's say, roughly 2.5 to 3 meters, you can call them the same. That's how close they are. However, look at this. Here are coordinates. These are UTM coordinates. Okay? That's fine. You put them in a coordinate system you want. Notice they're shown to three decimal places. And again, no information about how accurate this information is. So the user is left to believe, because it appears that they're to the nearest millimeter, oh, this data must have an uncertainty of just a millimeter or so, without any reference here in any part of this document that the origin of how these coordinates were defined were actually scaled from a NOAA, National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration, nautical chart, which had an uncertainty of probably around 40 to 50 meters itself. So this in if you're considering high accuracy information and sharing it like this, this kind of information becomes virtually useless. The last one I'll highlight over here is just another one. Benchmark, again from a surveyor's plat. Top of a concrete bound, so I know bound is a common term used in New England for surveying. Elevation 73.68 GPS datum. Well, what does that mean? 76.38, is that meters or feet? We can probably assume it's feet because so very few surveyors use meters, but you don't know. You don't know if it's meters or feet, and GPS datum, you don't know what the reference is there. So just some examples of bad metadata, and I'm sure many of you out there have probably already run into this yourselves. I want to very quickly highlight the relationship of the surfaces, and Sam talked about these. We're not going to go too far down the geodetic rabbit hole today because we just don't have the time, but I think it's important for everybody who's looking at data, and especially if you're going to use at a high accuracy level, the common coordinate systems of the United States, which are the state plane coordinates or the universal transverse Mercator grid coordinates. It's important to at least fundamentally understand the relationship of the various surfaces that we have to live with. One, of course, is the surface that we live and work on, this my little brown line that I have here. The other that you see in red, nice and curved and very regular, very systematic, that represents that reference ellipsoid or spheroid that Sam talked about. And for the United States, that ellipsoid is referred to as Geodetic Reference System 1980. The green line that you see here is commonly referred to as the geoid, an equipotential surface to which gravity is normal and most closely approximates mean sea level on a global basis. Regrettably, in the United States, that has not yet been fully developed. That's coming. That's coming. Coming 2022, the geoid, as I just defined it, a surface to which gravity is normal and most closely approximates global sea level, that will be our surface in 2022. As of right now, our height systems, our vertical datums, are referenced to a surface that approximates the geoid. So in the context of this slide, I'm calling them the same, although the difference is roughly about a meter or so, depending upon where you are. This is important to have at least a fundamental concept for, because in using the state plane coordinate system or UTM coordinates, for the surveyor or others who are capturing data in the field, making measurements, measuring distances, it's important that those distances be defined relative to the ellipse, the nice red line here, yet we're usually measuring them at some distance, our local distance, whatever we happen to be, height above or potentially below the reference ellipse. So it's an important factor in one of the reductions to actually taking that data and bringing it down to the reference ellipse. Again, this is one of those topics that I said can easily require a considerable amount of explanation and works much better with a 4-hour, 8-hour workshop. So let's look at the fundamental definition of coordinates, because the vast majority of acquire our coordinates today through GPS/GNSS measurements. As Sam was pointing out, most of us grew up, we had the map on the wall, the teacher came in, we were probably in the 5th grade, 6th grade, 7th grade, whatever, gave us a brief class on what latitude and longitude was. We put that in the back of our brains and have pretty much forgotten it since then. And it has very little to do with reality because the globe was spherical, not flattened, as Sam pointed out. And so today, users have the potential, whether it's you're acquiring technologies, this is very, very high-end, dual-frequency, geodetic-quality GPS, GNSS receivers, or even in a cell phone, you can easily acquire. Virtually every cell phone that's out there today can acquire GPS observations. And I've heard over and over and over again from users, oh, my GPS is giving me state plane coordinates, or it's giving me UTM coordinates. Well, the reality is that's just what the user has set in terms of their specifics in terms of how the data is being managed that you see on the screen. The reality is that GPS, GNSS, initially starts with a set of Earth-centered, Earth-fixed coordinates. That the origin of these coordinates, a little blue dot that I have here, is at or very close to Earth geocenter. And it's a three-dimensional coordinate system with zero with along each axis at Earth geocenter. Of course, there's positive and negative coordinates in there, which makes it a little interesting to use sometimes. Then that coordinate system is oriented. Again, going back to Sam's comments about defining the datum relative to the equator and to the prime meridian at Greenwich, which just for a point, if you've ever been to Greenwich and stood at the line or you happen to go there, that's not really where the prime meridian is anymore. It's about 100 meters away, but that's just a little fun tale. So the concept here is now from a GNSS receiver, I'm acquiring these three-dimensional coordinates, X, Y, and Z, and to make them into usable coordinates, ones that are more recognizable and usable for mapping applications, what we need to do is take this coordinate system, because you see this can go out into space as far as we want it to go. But we need to bring it into a framework that is more reliable and easily usable. So to that we add an orientation. That is, where is the north rotational pole? And then we add the reference ellipse so that we encapsulate this. And then from that, on any given point, we can now determine an X, Y, and Z coordinate of the phase center of the antenna, in this case, that are being used. And because there's a set of equations that are very rigorous, we can now take that X, Y, and Z coordinate and easily turn it into a latitude and longitude. Here you see the Greek symbols phi and lambda. Those are the common symbols used for latitude and longitude, or northing and easting, a state plane coordinate or a UTM coordinate. And this little h that you see here, that's an ellipsoid height. That means it's the height above or below our reference ellipsoid surface. It's typically not the height users want. That's a referred to as an orthometric height, which is derived through a geoid model. And again, we don't have the time to go into that in great depth today, but the National Geodetic Survey provides those geoid models for the United States. So if you take this latitude and longitude, or northing and easting, you apply to it the geoid model, you can now get, again, the latitude and longitude, or northing and easting, whichever you choose to use, and the appropriate orthometric height, which today represents our national vertical datum called the North American Vertical Datum of 1988. So just a little bit of geodesy there. So let's take a look at the two primary coordinate systems, which are state plane and UTM. And we'll give you a little bit of background on how they evolved. The state plane coordinate system was designed and developed by the Coast and Geodetic Survey, which is the previous name for the National Geodetic Survey, and as I mentioned, can trace its origin to 1807, established by Thomas Jefferson. The request came in 1933 from North Carolina, and it was assigned to one of the most prominent mathematicians at the Coast and Geodetic Survey, Mr. Oscar Adams. And Oscar just looked at this problem and he said, okay, what we need to do is that the Coast and Geodetic Survey had been performing surveys all across the country. These were being used for the framework for the topographic maps that was produced by the U.S. Geological Survey, or nautical charts as they were produced, and aeronautical charts as they were produced also by the Coast and Geodetic Survey. But for the average user, the average land surveyor who wanted to go out and use this national coordinate system represented by thousands of survey monuments scattered across the country, it was very, very difficult to to work in latitude and longitude because the computations are very, very time-consuming, very laborious, and the overwhelming majority of users back then, their computational capacity was very limited. Certainly, we had no high-speed computers. So the idea was to create a set of equations using map projections that would flatten out a small piece of the Earth, right? Not the whole Earth, but small pieces of the Earth, a state, right? And now to produce a set of northing and easting, or X and Y coordinates, that surveyors and others could easily learn how to compute, much like learning geometry that you would learn in high school, and not significantly different than that. Sam did a great job explaining the Lambert conformal conic and the transverse Mercator. Oscar Adams decided that these were the two best to use because of the properties that Sam has previously described. The Lambert conformal conic, best defining and having the least amount of scale distortion in states or parts of states that are more east-west. So Tennessee is a good example of that, Kentucky, the panhandle of Florida as a good example of that, Long Island in New York. The transverse Mercator, better describing and reducing the scale factor for states or parts of states that are more north-south. So Indiana, Illinois, the eastern part of Florida. They were designed along political boundaries. So they're not defined for any place except the United States, so there's an international boundary. It's not used in Mexico, it's not used in Canada. They're defined along state lines, so it's commonly referred to as the Maryland coordinate system or the Maine coordinate system, where our good friends at Blue Marble are, or whatever state you happen to be in, the Ohio state plane coordinate system. And they're defined in states that were broken up into different zones, north zone, south zone, east zone, west zone, central zone, which are commonly, you'll commonly see. They were designed along county boundaries so that the user said, if I'm in a particular county and I'm in a state that has more than one zone, then by definition, I know what the default coordinate system should be, Ohio north zone or Ohio south zone. Quite a number of states have a single zone, such as Maryland, where I'm speaking from, and you don't have to worry about that. But many states, especially bigger ones, California and Texas, have five or six zones, so the user needs to be aware of that. The zones were defined to be 158 miles wide. That seems like an odd number. And I've heard, but it reduces the distortion to one part in 10,000. That means if you go 10,000 feet, you have an uncertainty of 1 foot. And I've heard many times from surveyors and others tell me, I can't use state plane coordinates because they're only good to one part in 10,000. That's absolutely untrue. As long as the user follows the guidelines for using state plane coordinates, there's no loss of distortion in your measurements. All of the coordinates were defined in U.S. survey feet. Now, in reality, they were just described as feet, because at the time, 1933, we did not have the U.S. survey foot. And the conversions, that is, the transition for a surveyor or someone else to convert a latitude and longitude to a state plane coordinate, the Coast and Geodetic Survey produced tables, actual paper tables, and you could go and use those tables to perform the computations. Obviously, back then, there were no high-speed computers. By the late 70s, it became obvious because of changing positioning technology and requirements for the public that we needed to change the datum of the United States. And this goes, again, right back to what Sam had been talking about, a change in the size and shape of the model. So we went from one model, it was called Clark, 1866, Clark with an E, Alexander Ross Clark. His model best fit North America, but by the time we were looking at the late 70s, early 80s, it was obvious that the future was going to be some form of space-based positioning. So the National Geodetic Survey opted for a mathematical model that was best fitting globally, not locally, that is just North America. And one of the activities that came along with that is, well, what are we going to do with state plane coordinates? So because they're not used by the National Geodetic Survey, we went to the individual states. And the vast majority of states said, well, we'll just leave everything alone. But several states changed a variety of aspects. And I've just listed a few of them here. California dropped one zone. Montana went from three zones to a single zone. New Jersey moved their central meridian. So if you're working with data in both of those datums, NAD-27 and NAD-83, you need to be aware of that. All of the states got new faults, northings and eastings, defined in meters because that's what was originally defined by the federal government. The note that I have below, the U.S. Code 1952, Title 15, defines the metric standard. But in 1959, the Bureau of Standards had changed the relationship of the meter and the foot, which created what we now refer to as the international foot. Excuse me. So individual states, as they drafted their own state legislation defining state plane coordinates, they adopted whichever foot they wanted to use. The National Geodetic Survey had no influence on this. They simply went to the states and said, you can use whichever foot. So this is critical. If you, depending upon what state you're working in, different states may have a different definition of which foot's being used. And quite a number of times when I've worked with people because they've got conflicting information in state plane coordinates, it's because, oh, it's a state plane, it's a state that has adopted the U.S. survey foot, but somebody's generated coordinates in international feet or vice versa. And just as an example, and I'll show you those in just a moment. This map just gives you a highlight of the zones around the country, so you can see many states have multiple zones. Other states have singular zones, such as, you know, I live over here in Maryland, so we have a single zone, but notice Texas has five different zones, north, north central, central, south central, south, so you have to know where you are. The transverse Mercator. The transverse Mercator is not defined by any one specific agency. It's universally adopted, but it was originally developed by the Army after World War II. And Sam did a good job of explaining that, so it covers the whole Earth, basically almost from pole to pole. And the zones are 6 degrees wide, and they do not follow political boundaries. Typically, they are defined in meters in both NAD-27 and NAD-83. And again, to highlight what Sam said, if you're going to generate a coordinate, you should know what datum it's being referenced in. Here you see the zone boundaries for the United States. So if you happen to live in Nevada, for example, you can, the whole state is included in zone 11, but where I am over here in Maryland, well, the western part of the state is in zone 17 versus 18. And there's lots of reasons why some people would want to use one or the other state plane coordinates or UTM coordinates. And as Sam pointed out, it depends upon what your particular needs are. A couple of items I want to highlight. We don't have a lot of time, but the things you need to know or to have to utilize state plane or UTM coordinates. And I do want to highlight there's really kind of two ways to acquire the data. Oftentimes somebody is out wandering around with a GPS, GNSS receiver. They may have it tied into a local real-time network and the coordinates are just being read directly off of their data collector, or perhaps they're bringing the data into the office. And their generation of state plane or UTM coordinates comes specifically and only from those GPS or GNSS measurements, whereas you're oftentimes combining that with measurements made by usually by surveyors, where they're actually measuring distances and directions between points, typically in what's referred to as a traverse. And in those cases, then the elements that Sam highlighted, knowing which direction you're using, which azimuth, whether it's true geodetic grid, conversions between those two, the mapping angle that's referred to, convergence angle, the distances measured horizontal, which is a typical way that most surveyors would reduce their data. Now you have to bring it down to the ellipsoid, which in old days used to be referred to as the sea level reduction. Then you've got to either stretch it out or compress it to fit it inside the grid. And you can bring those two together and call them the combined factor. So you can see right away that there's a whole plethora of elements in here that really take more depth, more time to describe properly to assure you're getting the best information on how to use state plane coordinates. I just want to highlight very quickly here a couple of things. What you're seeing now is a typical National Geodetic Survey geodetic data sheet for one specific survey monument. I happen to pick this one in Massachusetts. I picked this one for a couple of reasons, although they're all pretty much the same. But just to highlight that this is the control information that's often used by surveyors to start producing new surveys, new data. And right at the top, you'll see the most current latitude and longitude and the ellipsoid height, which comes from those GNSS measurements. There's that X, Y, and Z, Earth-centered, Earth-fixed coordinate system that I mentioned previously. But on the same data, and it's often referred to as a data sheet, but of course it's a digital product, you will see the state plane coordinates. And here we have Massachusetts mainland. Massachusetts has two zones, mainland and offshore island. And the coordinates are produced in meters and in U.S. survey feet, as well as the UTM coordinates in meters. So the user is being given the latitude and longitude, the state plane coordinates, the metric values, the scale factor, and these convergence angles, that convergence angle being that difference between grid north and true north. I also wanted to highlight this particular one because it's something that many people are not fully aware of in terms of datum transformations and coordinate systems. The National Geodetic Survey provides quite a number of them, but here, if you look down here under superseded survey control, these are older coordinates for this one station. What you'll see are things that you may not be at all familiar with. USBS, USSD, USSD, the U.S. Standard Datum, which was the first comprehensive datum of the United States. USBS is the Bessel ellipsoid system, which was the very first coordinate system used in the United States. This station happens to have that because it's dated back to the 1830s. So in many areas, particularly coastal areas, users have needs for knowing what the older coordinates are and where they're available. NGS has them on their data sheets. I just want to highlight that as an element. Some publications that are available out there, and I give you a link here. The one you want to have, that everybody should have, is this one over here, the NOAA Manual NOS NGS-5 State Plane Coordinate System of 1983. The others I'm going to show you are for further reading, understanding the State Plane Coordinate System by Joe Dracup. This wonderful old document from the 30s about the definition of state plane coordinates, and this document here, the State Coordinate System, special publication of the U.S. Department of Commerce, was the definition for the old North American datum of 1927. There are a variety of utilities that will allow you to perform these conversions, many of them. Blue Marble has a great one, but I want to just highlight very quickly those that are used or that are provided free of charge by federal agencies. The ones that you see at the top are provided by the National Geodetic Survey as part of their geodetic toolkit online. You can go and run them online. Or a utility called CoreCom, which actually uses the utilities provided by the National Geodetic Survey into a more comprehensive package. So you can go and download these. At this point in time, I highly recommend you do not use the state plane coordinate conversion tool from NGS because it is just not very user friendly. If this is an issue for you, you want to have a tool that you can easily use, I very much recommend that you download the CoreCom program for the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers. That being said, NGS is committed to a brand new and much, much more widely developed new piece of transformation software that should be coming up soon, I'm told. soon. I wish I had a date for soon. I don't. So just very quickly to highlight, what you see here is state of Pennsylvania. It's broken into two zones. I've highlighted them in different colors here. And just to show you the parameters that we often refer to, in this case, the central meridian, about the central part of the state. And that's along that line that Sam pointed out where the grid azimuth and the geodetic azimuth or true azimuth are identical. As you move east or west, those angular differences are increased. There's a north and south standard parallel, meaning along these two parallels, the grid, the distance in the grid, and a distance along the ellipse or the geodetic distance are identical. In between them or outside of them, now those distances are either reduced or increased, and so the user needs to be aware of what the scale factors are if you're out actually making those measurements. And then, of course, you have the mapping angle, the convergence angle that Sam pointed out, and I'm not going to reiterate that. Here's just a quick example of the differences in coordinates from between the two datums, NAD27 and NAD83. I just picked a particular control station that happens to be near Harrisburg, Pennsylvania. Here's the northing and easting, one in feet, the other in meters. Notice that the convergence angles are virtually identical between the two datums, and the scale factor is virtually identical between the two datums, but the coordinate systems themselves are not. And when the new datum, NAD83, is converted to feet, both U.S. survey foot and international foot, and Pennsylvania is a U.S. survey foot state, then you can see if you don't know the right value, you can have a difference of, in this case, about 4 feet. That's not unusual at all. This map gives you a highlight of which states have adopted the U.S. survey foot, which are the states highlighted in blue. The ones in red have officially adopted the international foot. The two in yellow, Missouri and Alaska, have NAD83 legislation, but no foot conversion is specified. And the states of Alabama and Hawaii have no NAD83 legislation, so it's kind of wild, wild west, user beware. Just make sure you know what you're doing. We're running close to the edge of my particular section of this, but I want to highlight just a couple of things very quickly here. It's very, very common for users to want to have what they often refer to as ground level coordinates. And I've seen many, many people say, I want to take state plane coordinates and I want to raise them to ground level, or perhaps they want to use low distortion projections. There's a variety of ways to call them. It should be noted, ground level coordinates, whatever they happen to be called, are not state plane, even though the user may have originally started from state plane. That is one of those pieces of metadata that must be specifically identified, because it's very, very oftentimes a point of confusion if that's not critically mentioned. Some of the problems when you do that, and there's lots of reasons why users will want to do that, but just to highlight a few, I'm not going to go through each one of them, but I do want to highlight this one, the lack of documentation. Communities or companies or organizations that often do this typically do not provide the best documentation. So if you're inclined to do that, make sure that the documentation is a big part of whatever your decision-making process is. And I just highlight that again here, document, document, document. Very quickly, I want to highlight, because this is going to be coming up, Blue Marble just last time they had their discussion on the new datum, so I'm not going to go through it at great length, other than to say that the target date to replace NAD83 with a whole new geometric datum is January the 1st, 2022, and NGS does seem to be online with preparing that material to get it done. Here are some of the highlights. You'll be able to read them yourselves. One of the biggest issues is that NAD83 is not as geocentric as it could be. And what we are going to see in the not too distant future with improvements in space-based positioning is it's entirely possible that in a small unit, such as what we typically today refer to as a smartphone, we will be able to achieve better than 1 meter, many people say down to a few centimeters, without any ground control. So the capacity for making measurements is going to change radically over the next, at least the next decade. The U.S. will be launching a whole new replacement satellite system for GPS next year, starting next year, called GPS-3. And the fact that our current datum, NAD-83, is about a meter and a half disassociated with our best current knowledge of Earth Geocenter will play a big part in that. And you can see the variety of other elements that are important there. I just wanted to quickly move forward to talk about what will happen with state plane coordinates. And so if we look at the height, the positional difference, the National Geodetic Survey has been flying airborne gravity across the country since 2008. And because of that, they've generated a tool that will allow any user out there to predict what the changes in both coordinates and heights are going to be in your community with respect to the new datums plan for 2022. So I just wanted to highlight this. The areas in green are ones that have been completely flown. The airborne gravity is completely done. Many parts of the country still remain to be done, but they are very much on track with their plan to achieve this by the end of 2020. And I bring that up because there is a tool. Every year, NGS releases a new tool. They refer to it as a beta tool. It's a testing tool. It's not an official tool, but it allows you to determine what the positional and height differences are going to be in any given community with respect to the new datums. And it's referred to as geoid 16. That's the year it was generated. So the one you're looking at here was generated this year. X-geoid X, meaning it's a beta model. X-geoid B. And I'm going to click on it. Pardon me. I'm going to click on this real quick. And hopefully this will work quickly here. It'll take us to the NGS website. And if I have a coordinate, it seems to be slowing up. If I have a coordinate that's already known in my local system, all I have to do is go to this tool, enter the coordinates, as you see here, giving you a variety of ways to enter them, and it will generate for you what the new coordinates are and heights are going to look like in 2022. So the user can then very quickly determine, these are the offsets that we're going to see, and how does that impact me, my company, my agency, my clients, whatever they happen to be. So I highly recommend that you take advantage of looking at that to know what these changes are going to be. With respect to state plane coordinates themselves, the National Geodetic Survey, National Society of Professional Surveyors, and the American Association of Geodetic Surveying collaborated to draft a template for state plane coordinate legislation. Each of the 50 states, the National Society of Professional Surveyors as state director, have received a copy of that. So if you are a land surveyor and you're part of one of the state associations, you should be talking to the state director. If you're not a part of that, go find out who the state surveying association is in your state and talk to those state directors. Make sure that everybody is on board with what the new templates are going to look like. NGS is not planning any specific changes to zone boundaries, but that will be up. They are very much open to hearing from the states. So if you are in a state that might want to have a single zone and now has multiple zones, NGS is very much open to doing that. But the states can go and do anything they want. It's just a matter of what will be published by the National Geodetic Survey as part of the National Spatial Reference System.
Hey, Dave.
That's the last slide. Oh, yep.
Okay, I was just going to say, I think we're going to need to wrap it up and head towards questions here.
So I always end with good coordination begins with good coordinates, and geography without geodesy is a felony. We're doing a lot of this work through Blue Marble, and there you've got my contact information. All right, Sam, back to you.
All right, I will take back the screen here.
Yep.
Okay. And I think I've just got it back. I've just got a couple of a few more web examples that folks can take a look at out here. There's a few links there. The top link, that's the long and complicated one, that's a poster that you might actually run into at various conferences where the USGS is exhibiting. It's a very excellent map poster that describes a number of different projections, just on the basic level, not as a coordinate system, but the sort of high level theoretical of the projection, everything from your oblique Mercators to your conic projections, and I think it's about 15 or 20 examples of common projections in a very digestible format. The next two there are some resources that are a little more simplistic examples on some web maps that really let you take a look at things like area distortion of our common web Mercator maps. And the jasondavies.com link there is a very interesting interactive projection visualization tool. It actually warps a global image to suit a few different cartographic projections as well. Lastly, at the bottom there, if you're familiar with the webcomic XKCD, it's very, very commonly a sort of a web and tech-savvy comic. There was a map projections edition of that a few years ago. On what your favorite map projection says about you as a person. If you need a little bit of comedy relief here after all the heavy stuff we've been talking about, that's a good one for a chuckle. Now let's shift it on over to some question and answer. We're actually going to start off the question and answer by asking those of you who are still online here, we're going to ask you what projections you work with. So you should be seeing some options on screen there, and you can tick any number of those common projections. So everything there from state plane or the national grid for your particular country. I know we have a number of international users with us today. Looks like we've got a good assortment there for using something unusual or custom. And as usual, a small but dedicated group of geocentric users. I'm going to leave that open for just a few more seconds while I make sense of some of the questions that you've sent us in here that we'll get to in just a second. All right, I'm going to close that up in 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. And let's take a look at those results. Hopefully you should be seeing those on screen now. Looks like we've got a heavy use of state plane or your national grid for wherever you are. That is not shocking to me at all. Heavy universal transverse Mercator. UTM is probably one of the most overly used and misunderstood zone definitions there is. It's very convenient for most folks. A lot of systems around the world are actually sort of alterations of those common zones, so not a big surprise there. Good 20% of you using something else. Good lot of lat long. And then the geocentric and ECEF crowd, very heavy in things like satellite positioning. A lot of math is actually done at that level when we get talking about transformations and things like that. So always interesting to see the splits there. So I'm going to come back to our questions and answers. Oops, let's back up a slide there. Again, our contact information, and let's get into some of these questions that we've had come in. So Dave, I'm gonna toss this one over to you. Early on, we had a question. For collecting digital raster data over the continental U.S. in 1,000-meter square tiles, is an equal area projection appropriate? And if so, do you have any suggestions for what sort of parameters that might be broken?
Yeah, that is an area not in my realm of expertise. Actually, you know, I've worked most commonly with the two state plane projections, and I haven't done that kind of mapping, so I would hesitate personally to address that particular issue. Sam, you probably would have a much better grasp on that particular issue. I'm sorry that I don't.
Okay. What I would typically go after 1,000 meters by 1,000 meters is you're typically talking about a fairly small area in there. An equal area, you're mainly going to be talking about something like an Albers conic projection. If your intention is really is to be displaying the entire thing at once, which I kind of doubt if you're talking about a 1,000 meter square chunk there. If you need to be able to put the whole thing on screen at once, I would expect an equal area projection to be probably fairly okay. But I think it's probably much more likely that you're going to be focusing on smaller areas for that. There are common equal area projections, such as you'll find on the National Map data site, and that's I think it's nationalmap.gov. There's a very common Albers projection that's used for that. It's very often convenient to mimic something that already exists, so I would maybe start there as an investigation. Depending on the distortion that you're willing to tolerate in there, there are a number of the web tile formats, some of the web Mercator formats, or simply even lat long tiles can also work very well for just a simple, very large scale indexing. It is a sort of a broad open question, so I might encourage you to follow up with me after the session on that, and we maybe can go a little bit deeper on that particular topic.
Sam, there's a couple of questions there. I'd like to you already addressed them, but I'd like to expand on them a little bit if you don't mind. There's an earlier question. What is the practical key difference between the WGS84 and GRS80? I'd like to highlight that because it's very, as Sam's already pointed out here, it's very confusing. First of all, GRS80, Geodetic Reference System 80, was adopted as an international standard. 1979, by the International Union of Geodesy and Geophysics, so you have representatives from all around the world, got together and adopted GRS80 as the standard reference ellipse to be used anywhere in the world. That's in 1979. WGS84 was defined by the Defense Mapping Agency, which has gone through a number of name changes, now the National Geospatial Intelligence Agency, and it was not released until 1987. And in terms of the mathematics that define it, the difference between the size and shape of those two ellipsoids is millimeters over continental scale. So the mathematics for the two can be used interchangeably. The big difference comes up where it really makes a difference is when users start referring to the GRS80 part as the foundation for our national datum in the United States, NAD83, and a coordinate, an NAD83 coordinate versus a WGS84 coordinate. If they are both determined evenly at the same level of integrity, they could easily be different by about a meter and a half, not sub-millimeter as the two ellipsoids are. And that is due primarily to the difference in the origin of the coordinates. When NAD83 was first developed in the late 70s and early 80s and published in 1986, our knowledge of Earth Geocenter was about 2 meters. Today it's closer to 3 to 4 centimeters. And over time, the Defense Department has migrated WGS84, the datum, to be consistent with that international standard, which is commonly referred to as the International Terrestrial Reference Frame. So coordinates that are well-defined in WGS84 versus NAD83 could easily see a meter and a half. And there was the comment just below that, why does there have to be a difference between the U.S. and the rest of the world? Well, first of all, one of the problems, the United States, we were the first ones to ever develop a national coordinate system that was geocentrically based. Nobody had ever done this before. GPS was not yet a reality. And I don't think at that time that anyone could fully understand or appreciate how rapidly GPS was going to develop and how expansive it was going to be. So we have our national datum, NAD83, which differs, as I commented previously, about a meter and a half from the international standard, the ITRF. And in 2022, that's what NGS will do, is they'll adopt the ITRF, and differences between what we have in the U.S. and in the rest of the world will be considerably different. But you just don't change a national datum just to be consistent with the rest of the world, simply because you have such a vast amount of information that's already defined in it. So that's why we have this difference between what we do in the U.S. versus the rest of the world. Okay.
All right. Let's see here. I had another one lined up. On the state plane zone specifically, why not use a repositioned Mercator projection instead of a Lambert conformal conic for states with a more east-west orientation?
Well, that certainly could be done today. There's no reason to do it, not to do it today. The what would have to happen now is because the state plane coordinate system is, for one level or another, it's a standard. And those standards go back to the 1930s, as I mentioned, you know, the stuff that Oscar Adams came up with. And he didn't have those advantages. He took the simplest approach to this. So NGS has stayed with that simply because those are the standards that have been used. Now, with the new datum coming for 2022, if a state, if a community wants to change theirs, then they can petition NGS to do that. Because NGS does not use the state plane coordinate system, no one in NGS actually uses state plane coordinates. They work entirely in latitude and longitude, or X, Y, and Z, Earth centered or fixed coordinates. So NGS says this belongs to the states, and they will publish it as part of the definition of the National Spatial Reference System. If a state wants to change their projection, they should approach, you know, the groups in the state should get together, the land surveyors, the state DOT, the GIS community, come together, say, yes, this is what we'd like to do, approach NGS, and I can pretty much guarantee NGS will say, yeah, let's go do that, as long as the math is consistent.
Yeah, and we had a couple other questions that I fielded from some international folks earlier, talking about the numbers of coordinate systems we have here, and we do actually have quite a few. I think last week Dave and I were talking about some of the particular states here that are moving to another new thing that's even beyond the state plane zones, that are called low distortion projections, where they go even finer than the 3 to 6 or 7 zones that we might have in a state, and they're down at the county level. Some of the states actually have over 100 zones that they divide up by small. These are small municipal subunits. For those of you in other countries, those might be known as a council or a village unit, something like that. The individual states all control that themselves, and it's basically from the bottom up rather than the top down in establishing those systems. Here in Maine, our official state plane zone was 2. We were split right down the middle, east and west, with 2 transverse Mercator zones. And then a few years ago, we had it re-split into 3 slightly finer zones, still on transverse Mercator. Basically just to tighten up the areas that people were working in, and bringing those down to those lesser distortion in certain regions where it makes sense to do that.
And one of the reasons that these local coordinate systems have been so popular, whether it's a county coordinate system such as you see in Michigan or Wisconsin, or the low distortion projections, that are becoming so popular, is to reduce the amount of reference that people have to have on things like scale factors, so that it's almost almost always done either for property boundaries or for engineering aspects. So if somebody wants to lay out 300 feet of concrete or cut 300 feet of pipe, if they have grid coordinates, well, 300 feet in grid coordinates will be different than 300 feet of horizontal coordinates. And these are the uses that are typically found, and they can be quite confusing.
Okay, and so now I've got a good follow-on to this topic. For those of you that are still listening, we've still got a whole bunch of you online. Dave and I do have extra time. We agreed before the session that we could keep on going answering questions here. So we're going to stick around and keep handling some questions for a bit. So keep them coming if you've got any topics you want to join in on. Again, for those of you who are running short on time, if you do need to step away, we will be recording the rest of this session as well. So you can come back to it later if you need to. So instead of focusing on the small scale of local coordinate systems, I partially answered this with a short answer earlier, but there's a much longer answer as well. The question was, I understand that all map projections have distortions that vary depending on the particular projection used and the distance from the origin of that coordinate system. In the instance that the map or other data is in a nationwide coordinate system using something like an Albers equal area, and you're far away from the origin of the system, and you reproject the data to a coordinate system that is more localized, like a state plane zone, does the larger distortion of the original nationwide projection go away? Dave, you want to start off with that one?
No, I'm a little uncomfortable with this one. That's, again, not the best area of my expertise on projections. I'm going to have to leave that one to you, Sam.
Okay.
Sorry. Sorry, buddy.
So when you're dealing with a projection, something like an Albers, that is, you know, a very large, for those of you not familiar with Albers, it is it's called an equal area projection. It is a conic projection. So it's well suited to the middle latitudes away from the equator and away from the pole that are typically a little wider east-west than they are north-south. Now, the projection side of a coordinate system is actually fairly mathematically pure. There's not a lot of inaccuracy of the accuracy and precision side that comes and goes when switching projections. I'm going to come back to that. There's a little asterisk on that statement. When you go from something like a very large nationwide projection, that is simply one geometric description of your positions. When you switch to a different description of those positions, the quality of the data is not degraded. It is a mathematically pure conversion, rather than what we would call a transformation when you go from, say, datum to datum. So ignoring the datum for the moment, if you're going from something like an Albers projection down to a state plane zone or a UTM zone or whatever other kind of zone you can come up with, you should not be losing accuracy. You will also have different distortion. And so the key here is the definition of distortion versus the definition of accuracy. Distortion is not really inaccuracy. It is simply a mathematical relationship of things like the scales, the angular changes, all of those things that we can mathematically predict and accommodate. As long as you are sort of within the appropriate areas of those zones, such that you have, using your Albers example here, if you have nationwide data that is in Albers and you're going to squish it down into your local state plane zone, as long as you're using the data within the area of your state plane zone and you're essentially clipping off some of the rest of it, you're going to be fine. Your distortion is going to change to the scales and the angular changes that you're going to expect as a part of your normal state plane zone. It will be mathematically predictable. Where those things can go a little bit sideways is if you're doing something like changing to a coordinate system that is not mathematically appropriate for the area. So if you're doing something like here in Maine, we are completely contained within UTM zone 19. So a lot of folks work in UTM zone 19. Our neighbors in New Hampshire and Vermont, stretch over into zone 18. We can combine data from both of those places into zone 19, and it has distortions built into it that are then not within the design of zone 19. The scales go into ranges that were not planned for inside the zone. And if you go far enough over, so you start going three or four zones over, your measurements, you have a lot more work to do to keep track of things like your scale distortions on your measurements. And if you go far enough over in terms of zones so that you're well outside the area that is appropriate, math actually starts breaking down within these projection formulas. So depending on where you are, what tools you are using, there are actually different algorithms under the hood for things like transverse Mercator projections is a very good example. There's several versions of the transverse Mercator math. And depending on what software you are using, you can go farther outside the zones before the formulas themselves actually start breaking down. But that's the asterisk. As long as you are working within that area that's appropriate, and you're not, you know, trying to put, say, Washington State into a main state plane coordinate system, all of the things like the distortions are mathematically predictable. So the distortion changes, the accuracy doesn't, if that makes any sense. All right, now let's see here. We had another good follow-on from that. I've lost it in here, so I'm going to paraphrase. Someone earlier had asked, why exactly did we use Lambert conformal conics and break up some of those states into the strips north-south versus the strips east-west? Why didn't we just break them all up into strips of transverse Mercator zones when the state planes were designed? If you have any insight on that, Dave.
All right, so the state plane coordinates were, as I commented during my part of the presentation, they were designed to be along political boundaries, county boundaries, so that a user would always know if I'm in a particular county, particularly if it's a multi-zone state, you know, I will know what zone I'm in if I know how the zones are defined by those county boundaries. And the use of the Lambert conformal conic just fits so much better. If you take that cone and you split it down one side and you roll it out, you start to see that it's got an east-west direction to it. So it works much better for states or parts of states, as I mentioned, that are more east-west. And the idea of keeping the zones to about 158 miles was based on the surveying technology of the time. That is a transit, a surveyor's transit, and a tape, right? A standard surveyor's measuring chain, tape, not a chain, but a tape. And the overwhelming majority of surveyors who were not geodetic surveyors, there were so very few of those, that about the best that they could accomplish with those devices was a proportional uncertainty of about 1 part in 10,000. So part of Oscar Adams' architecture for state plane coordinates was, okay, if we build the zones so that the scale is no worse than 1 part in 10,000, then if the surveyor fails to utilize the grid scale factor because they don't know about it, which was very often the case, then the resulting coordinates will be no worse than the error sources in their measurements. Now today, of course, that's not true. I mean, the computers can do all of this, and the positioning is so much better today. But when they were designed back in the 30s, it was designed completely around the measurement capacity of surveyors of the time. So that's why they are the way they are.
Okay, we've got a whole bunch of short ones that I'm just gonna kind of bite off quickly here. I'm gonna paraphrase, it was a kind of a long comment. A gentleman was talking about working with folks who don't realize that a circle, a geometric circle within the context of a latitude-longitude system in a GIS is not actually a circle on the ground when you map it out, relating to differences in distance and differences in scale. I'm going to just toss out a vocab word here, and I'll let you folks look this one up. But a great example to show folks who are not really aware of some of those distortions in map projections for when you're taking this outside the context of your geography department is something called a Tissot's Indicatrix, and that is T-I-S-S-O-T. Tissot's Indicatrix, and that is it's basically a collection of circles, equidistant circles, that you can distribute around your map, that you can show the distortion within a particular projection. So you start off with basically equidistant circles mapped out. There's a lot of layers available on the web. You can Google these and find them as shape files, as GMLs, and etc. They're very handy for plotting within a mapping project. Just to remind your non-GIS folks of what's going on with a projection. Let's see here. A few more just sort of general questions. Are there any known issues with the Proj 4 projection implementations in the horizontal sense? Just very quickly, Proj 4 is one of those standards that's been around for a long time. Like anything, there are failure points, mathematical failure points in any of the algorithms. When you get too far outside the area, a particular thing is a coordinate system is based on. But you'll actually find Proj 4 at the heart of a lot of various transformation solutions out there. Following on that, does UTM have to use meter as its linear unit? That's a slightly loaded question. If you want to call it UTM and use US feet or international feet, that's a rub for the folks who defined it, because it is defined as metric, but you will find folks all over this planet using a UTM projection with an alternate linear unit. All that does is makes it a new projected coordinate system with different linear units used for reporting its positions and distances within. A very related question to that is a little farther down about, and actually some folks are adding questions along saying that should not be allowed. I'm not even just talking about feet here. There are places around the world that are using alternate survey units such as chains and links in those. Ultimately, it doesn't matter. If you are identifying that as a pure, UTM zone, X, whatever your zone is, if you're going to identify it with something like an EPSG code or any code that looks it up in a commonly known database, then you run into problems, because the linear unit used internally in a coordinate system is defined by that system. However, it is very common practice for folks all over the world to use whatever their locally standard survey unit is. A related question to that was on the what are called the BLM coordinate systems that are used here in the States. Is that a sigh I heard there, Dave? The BLM zones are used in most commonly in the Gulf of Mexico offshore. For delineating things like petroleum exploration lease blocks. The BLM zones are a very good example of this. They simply are the UTM zones, and they actually even retain the UTM zone number, but they're on a different horizontal datum, and they have a different linear unit. They use the US survey foot, and they use the NAD27 horizontal datum. That by definition is no longer a pure UTM coordinate. It's not on WGS84, which is the UTM standard. It's not using meters, which is the UTM standard. But it is the same projection. It is centered in the same place, It is a different coordinate system because it reports different linear units in its positions and in its outputs. You'll find in the EPSG database, they're very, very common in the EPSG database. For those of you not familiar with the EPSG database, the EPSG is essentially the de facto standard for reporting coordinate systems internationally. It was originally a project of the EPSG was a European Petroleum Survey Group. That group itself is now defunct, and it has evolved into an international group of folks all over the globe, and it is actually now also an ISO standard. As such, it is showing up in file formats all over the place. Things like LiDAR headers in an LAS file. You'll find EPSG codes as standardized identifiers. In GeoTIFF headers, the same thing. EPSG codes are very often recognized as a standard way to identify a coordinate system. Within the UTM, within the EPSG database, there are a vast number of things called UTM zone, whatever zone number, on a local horizontal datum for whatever part of the world you happen to be in. Essentially, whatever national datums are used or regional datums are used in a particular area, they will also be defined as a variant of the UTM zones broken up for that part of the world. We've said it a few times now, UTM is one of the most commonly used projection systems in the world, but there is nothing special or unique about the projection part of it. It is simply 6-degree zones evenly spaced around the globe. Functionally, you can put them on whatever datum you want to put them on. You can use whatever linear units you want to use within that context, but it's not purely the original definition of UTM. It doesn't match any of its EPSG codes as you start doing that, and you will offend some folks academically by doing that as well. let's see here. Quick one from here in the States. Should I be using just NAT83 or the NAT83 HPGN State NADCON?
NADCON, first of all, is a tool. It's a transformation tool. So it doesn't define a datum. NADCON is actually a transformation tool that goes between, that allows the user to compute relationship between NAD27 and each of the state's HARNs, the high accuracy reference networks that were observed back in the 90s and early 2000s. The user should be using whatever is the latest set of coordinates published by the National Geodetic Survey. Now, that today is called NAD83 parentheses 2011. The HARN in a state is often used by many surveyors, and as long as it's defined, as long as you, if you want to use that coordinate system because you've got clients who say this is what we want to use, as long as you provide that as part of the metadata, and for whatever state you're in, all you have to do is look up some of the geodetic control in the NGS database, and it will tell you what the date is. So each HARN was given its own specific date. So for example, here in Maryland, where I am, it's NAD83 1991. As long as you provide that with your data, then anyone later on can go back and perform a transformation from your data into the most current reference frame. But you know, do you have to use it? Well, actually, I would say you should use whatever is the most current, and that is NAD83 2011.
And that's something that's coming along in a lot of software. Speaking from the software industry side of that, a lot of other folks out there, our partners, our competitors, defining some of these nuances of NAT83, you'll see a lot of different language in a lot of different places. in things that are sort of more geodetically minded, you'll see more of those variations of the Nat83s and the European counterparts and the Australian counterparts as we all move towards these temporally based coordinate systems. It's a very interesting time to be in our industry right now. On the transformation options still, I'm going to have to step to the plate and plug some software here for a second. The question is there a more user-friendly option to the VDatum application for converting vertical datums? That is my job. That is what we do here at Blue Marble Geographics. You can find all of the various VDatum reference geoids available in our geographic calculator application. That's our main data conversion package here. And you can also find them in Global Mapper, which is our desktop GIS, if you've got the geographic calculator sidled up next to it. We have basically all of the North American geoid models available for NAVDE88, NGVD29, HTDP for all of your time dependencies on the horizontals as well, and all of the individual variances of the reference frames available. That's if you're familiar with the movie Office Space, that's what we do here.
Sam, are you also including all the tidal datums?
Yes, we have all of the tidal datums from VDatum baked in as well now. Yep. Trying to sort through all these questions that you folks have sent in. It's been really, really great reading all these things. I'm going to have to paraphrase. I can't find the question in front of me in the list, but the question was, do you have any general guidance for working at areas of very high separation from the ellipsoid in terms of the coordinate systems? You got anything to say about that, Dave?
High separation, I'm going to assume.
High elevation.
High elevation. Well, the issue there... As Sam already pointed out, as long as you're taking care of the scale factors, then it's really not a problem. The process of taking data at high elevations, let's say you're working in some place like Denver, the computation, the equation to take a measurement from 10,000 feet or 14,000 feet or even 15,000 feet down to the reference ellipse is quite simple. It's not really very difficult at all. The problem that many users have faced, or at least have expressed to me, is that now once I have a grid distance or a geodetic distance on the ellipse, it is significantly different than my horizontal distance at my ground level at a mile up or 10,000 feet or whatever it happens to be. And the only thing you can do there, if that is an issue for you, is to investigate the use of a local coordinate system such as a low distortion projection that we both mentioned earlier. If your need is to maintain your distances that would be commonly referenced at local level, I mean at ground level with the corresponding grid distances, that's pretty much the only way you can do it. And larger height differences are significant that way, but in terms of using things like state plane coordinates and getting the right answer, because this goes exactly to what you said, Sam, as long as you use the appropriate modeling, there's no loss of data integrity. I think I was having problem with my audio when you were commenting about the question about the national projection and changing a projection to something local, and as you explained it, the question became clearer to me, and you hit it right on the head. To me, it's no different than that issue of saying I have an Earth-centered, Earth-fixed coordinate. I want to convert it to a latitude and longitude or a state plane. As long as you follow the appropriate mathematics, because there's no distortion in the math, absolutely none. And as long as you follow that, there's no loss of data integrity. The user just has to understand that.
Yep.
I hope that answers.
So I think let's just take a couple more here, and then I think we're going to have to wrap this up for today. And so for those of you, there are a few here I know as we're going to sort through the questions that are logged into the session here. We'll have the recording posted within a couple days' time. It'll be available right on the Blue Marble webinars page. If you're familiar with our website, it is bluemarblegeo.com. On the toolbar there, there is a link into our webinars page. It will also be, if you are a subscriber of our YouTube channel, you'll automatically get a notification when it hits YouTube in a couple of days. And as well for questions that we haven't had a time to get to as we sort those out, we'll follow up over the next few days directly via email with any of these ones that we haven't had time to get to today. We've had a whole lot of questions here. There's still actually over 100 of you still listening, which is really, really refreshing. Do any tools yet handle the old North American, tripping on my tongue. Let's try that again. Do any tools yet handle the old North American datum natively? I'm going to assume that you're going back beyond NAD 27, and I'm going to assume that you're talking about the American General Survey datum. And Dave, do you want to take that one? Or?
Yeah, I will. The North American datum, U.S. North American datum, was adopted in 1901. It was a rename of the U.S. I'm sorry, it was in 1913. It was a rename of the U.S. standard datum, which became the first national datum of the United States. It was changed in name only because it was adopted by the Canadians. NADCON, the transformation tool that NGS produces, does have transformation in there from the North American datum or the U.S. standard datum, whichever you want to call it. They're the same. Has the transformation for areas that were covered by the datum. But understand, not all areas were covered. Let me give you an example of that. When I say covered by the datum, what I'm referring to were the surveys that were actually conducted by the U.S. Coast and Geodetic Survey, former name for NGS. And at those times, the turn of the last century, the arcs of triangulation were very, very sparse. So what happened is agencies like, and this is where you see a significant amount of this, the U.S. Geological Survey, who were in the process of doing the topographic mapping of the country, would produce their own coordinates in the U.S. standard datum that might be hundreds of miles from where the original source was, from the trunk lines of triangulation that the Coast and Geodetic Survey had performed. That being said, the transformations that NGS is providing in the NADCON tool, and ostensibly there's a new one being released sometime in the next couple of months, and it will include that, will not cover those areas. So you have to be kind of aware of the areas that you're involved in, whether it's the old datum of the North American datum, U.S. standard datum, or older vertical datums. And if anybody out there has a specific question on that, I'm more than happy to address that personally. On a specific basis.
Okay, and so I think there's a whole bunch in here that we're going to have to follow up to via email, but there's a good theoretical one here to wrap up altogether pretty much everything we've been talking about for the last 2 hours. So a specific case posed by a user, what would I use for a general map showing Arkansas, Louisiana, Missouri, and Alabama all together? So this is basically the perfect exercise to do a little bit of research on your specific needs out on the map. This goes back to my question mark slide of how do you choose a projection. Yeah. First step might be simply to do some research and find, is there anything already commonly in use covering those areas? Are there maybe any state or interstate agencies that do mapping specific to that region that would have a projection that would already cover your needs? Beyond that, let's assume there just isn't. Beyond that, you need to start putting your own needs on it. So the first major step in narrowing down what you might want to use is, where are you? You've already firmly established that with your four state working area. Now, thinking just off the top of my head, I'm looking around my own office here to see if I have a map of U.S. states, and I have a nice world map, but I'm having a hard time visualizing the extents of those states. But I believe that that gives you a fairly squarish area. So you're maybe not too far north south, not too far east west in your extent. So you're going to have some flexibility. But you are in that sort of mid-latitude ranges that we talk about, being away from the equator, but not being all the way up towards the poles. So you're very firmly in that range where conic projections start coming in. So there's a number of conic projections. There's a number of sort of stereographic projection options that you might consider. You might even be okay with a wide enough transverse mercator. But that next step really comes down to, what do you need to do with that map that you're going to make? Are you looking to measure, I'm just going to make some stuff up here and say, are you trying to measure square area of land assets across that area? Are you trying to measure distances between points throughout that area? Or are you simply trying to make a nice cartographic display that's going to look cool hanging on the wall and convey some basic border information or just some basic distribution information? Those sort of narrowing down questions are going to guide you into the properties of that map that you need, whether you need something that is equidistant, whether you need something that is equal area, whether you want something conformal. So that it has a visual appearance of the shapes that we're familiar with. I have a feeling if you're looking for a sort of a general tip in a direction, if you're going to make up one new, I would speculate that you'd probably do fairly well by coming up with a conic projection, very commonly either some variation of an Albers conic projection, Albers equal area, or a Lambert conformal conic. If you are simply making a nice-looking wall map to convey some very basic information without needing measurements on it, that would probably be a good starting point. And in terms of setting up the parameters for that, you're going to be looking at figuring out what latitude you're at that point. Find a nice mid-latitude for you. Try some options. There aren't really too many hard and fast rules in terms of making up your own coordinate system for cartographic display. Where you need to be a lot more careful is if you're actually going to be making measurements of any kind within that projected space. Dave, I don't know if you have anything you want to add on to that, or if you actually know of anything for that area.
Pretty much covered that whole. That's an area outside my realm.
Okay.
But I would do, the one thing I would say is, as you already said, look at an area or a group that might have a projection that they're already using, maybe the U.S. Geological Survey or somebody like that.
Yep. And there's a lot of projections already out there.
Oh, God.
We have 90 base projections that are still used around the world in modern times. There's one of them that gets overused, transverse mercator. People can't get enough transverse mercator these days. unless you're doing worldwide maps, doesn't work so well. But if for smaller regions like this, a lot of folks just simply try and stretch out a transverse mercator as best they can to fit an area. There's a lot of room for better creativity than that, though. So if you are trying to look up a very specific example to suit a particular purpose, definitely feel free to follow up. Hit us at these email addresses, and I'm happy to sort of try and help guide you into another direction for maybe doing a little bit of next step research to see if there's any existing standards and such. But Dave and I would like to thank you all for attending today. I'm really impressed at how many of you are actually still online and listening to us. Again, we'll be posting this up on YouTube in the next couple of days. I'm going to have to just do a little bit of video processing and clean up the audio a bit, and we will get this posted up as soon as we can. Again, that's going to be on our YouTube channel, or come right back to our main Blue Marble homepage. I believe Dave will also have a link up to it probably eventually. And yep. If you're at all lost for trying to find this recording, if you're hoping to refer back to it, feel free to shoot either of us an email, and we'll get you pointed in the right direction. With that, I'd just like to thank everyone for attending again, and thank you for joining me, Dave.
Yep, thank you very much. Appreciate it.
All right. Good afternoon, everyone.
Everybody have a great day.